one of his lessons.
Quick snapshot done, and then come back on Easter and see how we have used it. I hope that you will be inspired and pleased by it. John Chance has asked me to remind you about the trip to the art museum that is this Friday. You know, our Lenten devotional is tied to works of art in the North County Museum of Art this year. So there's information about that in your bulletin. You can meet here in the front of the church and travel as a group to the museum for what I'm told is just an amazing tour of these particular works of art. Also, I am looking around and seeing some children in the room, and I just want to remind parents of our policy with regards to children. Children should not be wandering around the building unaccompanied. So even if they are going to the restroom during a worship service, we just love your children, and we always want them to be safe, and we always want them to be partnered with you when they are elsewhere in the building. So this is just a friendly reminder of that policy. For now, we remember that we are here for worship, and we just take a deep breath in, we breathe in the Holy Spirit, and let us begin. Thank you. through Lent as we step inside the story of a teacher who turned our world upside down. And we pause this morning to put ourselves in the picture of Holy Week so that we might take a closer look at this ancient story and allow it to open us to deeper conviction for the call to follow Jesus.
Into the story, into the place you belong, not just looking on. Oh, this is your story. Into your story. Come into the story, into the place you belong, not just looking on, for this is your story, into your story.
Jesus's actions at the Last Supper shocked everybody who was in attendance that night in the upper room. Today, we enter the scene long enough to grasp the shock that would have rippled through him, through his friends, as they saw him take this posture of a servant and wash their feet. It was time for the disciples to get the message. And Jesus said to them, "Just as I have done for you, now you do for one another."
Into the passion, into the place we belong, not just looking on, for this is our passion. Enter the passion.
Let us join now in our confession. Lord, sometimes we fail to pay attention to difficult situations or the needs of your people. Forgive us, O God. Guard us from distancing ourselves and help us to care for what's right in front of us. You entered our story through Jesus. Now help us to enter fully into the story of your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Now know this. Our lives contain continual opportunities to be in humble service to friends and strangers. You are forgiven and freed, encouraged and loved by a God who wants you to live fully. So in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now let's stand and greet each other, entering the passion of Christ. The peace of Christ be with you and also with you.
Stand up, because we're going to start singing. Yeah, yeah.
We can get some exercise and go back and forth.
That's right. All right, this is One More River to Cross.
I've gotten down to the troubles and trials in my little lifespan. When I'm standing all alone and the fires get hot, I do the best that I can. I must have crossed a million valleys, must have shed a million tears. But when I come through the river of Jordan, hallelujah, then I'll have no fear. I got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my worries behind. One more battle with the devil, and he better understand I'm going through with Jesus, hallelujah. Holding to his nail-scarred hand, holding to his nail-scarred hand. I've had a lot of people talk about me since I walked this narrow way. It's just another valley that I came through when I got on my knees to pray. I climbed a lot of mountains, crossed a lot of little streams. But when I see old Jordan cold and dark, that'll be the last for me. I've got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil, and he better understand I'm going through with Jesus, hallelujah. Holding to his nail-scarred hand, holding to his nail-scarred hand. I got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil, and he better understand I'm going through with Jesus, hallelujah. Holding to his nail-scarred hand, holding to his nail-scarred hand. One more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil, and he better understand Jesus, hallelujah. Holding to his nail-scarred hand. Holding to his nail-scarred hand. Holding to his nail-scarred hand.
All right, awake a little bit. Go ahead. This is Tis So Sweet.
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you.
Start reading Psalm chapter 13, verses 3-16. Which is the cycle of faith, keeping knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God, and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wrap them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bath does not need to wash except for my feet, but is innately clean, and you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "None all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, but that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also called to wash one another's feet. For I have said you in simple that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are managers greater than the one who sent them." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The image starts with the full art slide and then zooms in on the part of the painting that depicts the speaker, the servant. My master's banquet hall had been reserved for this night, and the time had come for the group to gather for their banquet. All was prepared according to their wishes, and I was ready with the water and basin, as I always am. Years ago, my parents had given me to the owner as collateral for the debt they owed him. But things didn't go well for them, and the debt had never been paid off, so I work to pay it off. The law says that someday I could be a free person, but I'll never again have all the rights of those who have never been slaves. I'm marked for life. I keep my head down and do what the master asks, because he has the right to punish. I've witnessed it happen to others. Right now, I have no rights. So there I was with the bowl, waiting for the sign to start. The honored guest would go first, of course. I would know who he was by where he was seated. When the teacher showed up, I recognized him and remembered the stories I had heard about him. He had said things that upset the people who cared about the system of status that controlled the lives of people like me. The last shall be first, he once said. My friend who serves in the kitchen had to tell me to stop staring. I just couldn't imagine a world like he described. And then he came up to me and took the basin of water from my hands. He took my servant's towel and wrapped it around his own waist and knelt, telling Peter to come sit down. This was going to be night like no other, and I realized my life was never going to be the same.
For reading and Danny, also for reading today on your birthday. Nice act of service on your birthday. Let's take a moment to pray. Yeah. See, an act of service right there. Let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, 6 years ago this month, I was serving as a pastor at a church in Chapel Hill, and I was invited to move to the mountains. I was offered a job as the director of program ministries at Lake Junaluska Conference and Retreat Center. It's about 25 minutes on the other side of Asheville, and it's this place where Methodists have been gathering since 1913. And so a place near and dear to my heart. It has a 3,000-seat auditorium, Stewart Auditorium. It has lots of lodging and meeting rooms, and so this was an interesting opportunity. But I loved my job that I had in Chapel Hill, so I was really, on the fence. Do I pick up my family and move all the way across the state to take this opportunity? And so I began to talk to people, and some people talked to me, and they talked about status, and they said, Mitzi, you've got to take the job. You know, you're going to have a voice at the table. You know, your role there, you're going to be able to shape things and change things, and you really should do it. And then my district superintendent said, Mitzi, what a neat opportunity. And she talked about experiences. And she said, just imagine the people that you're going to get to meet and the stories you're going to hear and the creativity that you're going to get to exercise, and it's going to grow and stretch you as a pastor. You really should do it. And then my friends were like, it's the Smoky Mountains. You should do it. Right, which I get, right? So status and opportunity and scenery, but there were definitely some other things that I needed to consider. And the fact was that 7 years before this offer was made to me, the United Methodist Church, in a moment of recession and a moment of belt tightening, had cut entirely the $1 million a year subsidy that they were paying Lake Junaluska, so that apportionment money had been supporting the conference center, and that year it was cut completely. And The grounds and the hotels were sort of tired from deferred maintenance. It was looking a little, not as well as it should look. Visitation was down by 17% over a four-year period. And by the time I was offered this position, things were improving for sure, but the challenges loomed large. And to make things worse, the position I was being offered had been vacant for a whole year before. The department was in disarray, and everyone who I talked to who was on the staff or knew the conference center gave me big flashing warning lights about the immense challenge of not only rebuilding that department, but being a part of making the whole conference center sustainable. So this was a lot. And so I took it in, and I thought about it, and then I said yes. And so I went there, but it had nothing at all to do with status. It had nothing at all even to do with experiences. And it had nothing, it had a little bit to do with it being in the mountains, I confess. But what it really had to do was I said yes, because the executive director at the time, Jack Ewing, who had taken the helm of the conference center, was an amazing servant leader. And quite simply, I wanted to work for him. Jesus teaches servant leadership all throughout the Gospels. It's a cornerstone of who he is. He says it all the time. We hear him in the Gospel of Mark tell his disciples, among the Gentiles, their leaders lord their leadership over them. They are tyrants. Those who are great act as tyrants. And he goes, but you disciples, whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. Servant leadership. You've probably heard about it. If you even in the secular world, it's sort of a movement that is happening and growing and expanding. And if you've worked in business, you've probably read leadership books like ones by Ken Blanchard. And he says it this way: servant leadership is about making the goals clear and then rolling your sleeves up and doing whatever it takes to help your people. In that situation, they don't work for you, you work for them. So Jesus is at the Last Supper he will ever eat with his disciples, and they're gathered in the upper room, and we just heard Blair tell us the story, and he takes off, he takes a towel, and he wraps it around his waist, and he gets down on all fours, and he washes the disciples' feet. Now, normally this was a job that was reserved for slaves, and actually even they didn't really wash the people's feet. They would just, their job was to provide the basin of water, just to put it before them. But Jesus actually goes a step further, not only taking on the role of a servant, but doing the washing. And as I learned more about servant leadership from my new manager, who was Jack Ewing, I knew that whatever the challenges would be, that I was following someone that I could respect and that I could admire. Not only did I want to be led by him, but I moved to Western North Carolina because I wanted to lead like him. I wanted to follow him, to learn the way that he led. And the mission that we were trying to accomplish with really very, very, very limited resources in a super challenging time, just put so much before us. But a servant leader excels in times like these because of a couple of reasons. One, they show by example that there is a mission worth doing. Two, they do the mission, which shows us that it can be done. And three, they inspire the ones who follow them to copy them, imitate them, and do it themselves. So going back to this first key, I'm sorry, this music stand keeps going down. Are y'all noticing this? I keep pulling it up and it keeps going down, and these mature eyes have trouble with that. But the first key aspect that Jack demonstrated for me, that Jesus demonstrates for us, is to identify what the mission is. And Jesus lays it out for us simply: love one another. As I have loved you, love one another. And as he talks about this, he inspires all these people around him, right? Love one another. So when I moved to Lake Junaluska, Jack, one of the reasons I wanted to work for him was he made the mission crystal clear. And he said, you know, if we show our guests love, if we greet them in Christian love, they're going to come back, because who doesn't want to feel love? And then he expressed a mission for us all, and everyone on staff could say the mission. In fact, everyone in the whole community could say the mission, and that was to become a place of Christian hospitality where lives are transformed by the renewal of soul, mind, and body. Man, I wanted to be a part of that. What pastor doesn't want to be in a place and in a position where lives are transformed by the renewal of soul, mind, and body? And so we knew if we did those things, if we did nothing else but welcome people in Christian love and give them a place of renewal, that the lake would get healthier. The second key aspect of servant leadership is to prove that the missions can be done when the leader does the things for himself or herself. Jesus just doesn't want to clarify these rules. He's not concerned with status or tradition as he gets down on all fours and goes from person to person with that towel and that basin, just scrubbing that Middle Eastern mud from their toes and their heels. He doesn't care about tradition. He doesn't care about rules. He just wants them to see that the mission can be done, that he's willing to do it. One of the things that Jack did as a servant leader was to show us that he was never asking us to do anything that he would not first do for himself. And so sometimes we'd have these big conferences come in, and they would check out like at 10 in the morning, and another conference would come in at 3, right? And we're talking thousands of people. And we just didn't have enough housekeepers to turn over all the hotels and the lodging, you know, in hours. And so Jack would roll up his sleeves and off he would go to make beds. And he would ask us on the management team to come and make beds too. And sometimes I would be driving into the entryway to Lake Junaluska. There was this median that was supposed to be manicured by the Department of Transportation, and Jack would be out there with his weed whacker, you know, clipping the weeds to make the entranceway to the conference center beautiful. Or I would see him clearing tables in the dining room. He was a servant leader. And even more, in his first year of leadership, or I guess his second year, the lake miraculously made a profit. And he went to the Board of Trustees and said, you know, this is the first profit we've made in a long time, and I think it needs to go back to the employees. And so he took the profit, he divided it equally by the number of employees, and it didn't matter if they were a housekeeper or a desk clerk or a director or a manager, everyone walked into a meeting and walked out with an extra $1,000 in their paycheck. Because he wanted to pass the profits that had come through the fruits of their work back to them. That is what a servant leader does. And the third thing that a servant leader does is it inspires the other people to do the same. And that's what Jesus does, right? He's talking to the disciples and he's reminding them that as their Lord, he's just washed their feet. So nothing about position or status should keep them from doing the same to other people, right? He wants them to do what he has done. Radical acts of service may never be the way of the world. I don't see a lot of people going around washing other people's feet. In fact, when we have our Maundy Thursday service here, we have a foot washing station, and I would say 3/4 of the people avoid it. It's just scary. It's scary to have your feet washed or to put your hands around someone else's feet. I know my aunt is a nurse, and she says, you know, that's one of the most meaningful parts of her job as a nurse is when she gets to bathe people and wash their feet. And she'll see people on the street, and they'll come up to her, you know, years later and say, I remember when you nursed me. I mean, I remember when you bathed me. I remember when you washed my feet, because it is such a radical act. And so we at Lake Junaluska, when we would see Jack roll up his sleeves and make beds, of course we would make beds. And of course we would begin to live out that mission of hospitality and love, not only for our guests, but for each other. And we begin to change the culture from a culture of not my job to a culture of what can I do to help you. And we did that for each other And of course, that rolls over to the guests, and they start writing on TripAdvisor and all these kinds of things, like, wow, what's going on at Lake Junaluska? Like, the people are so friendly there, and they're so hospitable. This new eye for servanthood rippled through the conference center. And I have to tell you, it's risky to lead this way. Can you imagine the guts it took to go to a board of trustees when you finally made a profit and to say, let's give it away? Or can you imagine in Western North Carolina, I mean, friends, this is a place where, when you go to shop or something, there'll be a sign on the door that says, like, I've gone bear hunting or snowboarding or rock climbing. There's not a lot of polished loafers there. Like, this is a place where people go out and they do things. So servant leadership can look a little bit soft from the outside. So why risk leading that way? And if you ask Jack, I think he was a lifelong Christian. He sang in the church choir. He would have said, I lead this way because Jesus did. Servant leaders, first and foremost, are motivated by love. It can't be anything else. And Jesus' love for his disciples was undeserved. It was unending. It was unconditional. It was unselfish. And it wasn't because of their worthiness that drove Jesus to wash their feet. He wasn't expressing gratitude. He was expressing grace. I do this for you out of love. So I want to challenge you this week. I wonder if you might show a little servant leadership in your neighborhood, in your house, just while you're out shopping. And don't pick the obvious person. Don't pick the person that it's easy to do it for. Pick the person it's hard to do it for. Don't filter who your recipient is. Remember, Jesus washed Judas's feet. And Judas betrayed him. Pick the unexpected person. A friend of mine last week went to see the movie A Jesus Revolution, and she told me about it because she had taken her brother, who has not been in a church in many, many years. And he went with her to see this movie. She was surprised that he did it. But they were sitting there, and when they walked out, he said, you know, if I could find a church like that, I'd go to it. And the scene that made him say that was quite naturally a foot washing. In the movie, there's this pastor, and, you know, he's in a church, and the church is quiet, and the church is staid, and the church is stilted, and the church is judgmental. And the pastor meets up with this hippie preacher. This is like in 1968. So he meets up with this, you know, back in the day, they might call him Jesus freak or Jesus people. And the guy just convinces him that that there's all of these people out there who are desperate, who want to hear a message of truth and love, but if the church doesn't let them in, how are they going to hear the message? And so the pastor in the story invites this hippie evangelist into his church, and of course the people get grumpy. I don't remember the man's name in the movie. I'm going to call him Mr. Grumpy Pants, but Mr. Grumpy Pants, you know, comes up and he's like, these people are coming in with their bare feet, and we've got new shag carpet. He's like, oh, by all means, let's protect the shag carpet. But Mr. Grumpy Pants is like, you know, fussing at him, and you think he's won because he's telling him, like, look, we pay your salary. We're the givers of the church. You're scaring us off. You're scaring off the people. And I'm watching this, and I'm like, oh, this is so sad because he's going to cave in, and he's not going to do the thing. And the next scene, there's this long line of hippies outside the church, and they're waiting to get in, and Mr. Grumpy Pants comes up, and he's like, what is happening? And at the front of the line is the pastor, and he has a basin of water. And he's thinking, you're worried about the carpet? Well, let me wash their feet. And one by one, he's washing the feet and saying, welcome home. Welcome home. Go in. Take a seat. John Ruskin once said that the highest reward for a person's toil is not what they get for it, but what they become by it. That's the reward for our toil. And so what the pastor in the movie becomes is a servant leader, and he also becomes joyful. And his joy is contagious, and the church gets so big, it has to move out into a tent, and it quickly outgrows that, because spreading Christian love with no thought of getting anything in return is the entryway to joy and blessing, isn't it? May we all show through our actions what can be done so that we can inspire other people and they will do it too, and maybe we together will start a Jesus revolution. Let's pray. God of grace, we are so thankful that you are a God of grace, that you did send your Son to us to show us how to serve. May we look for the surprising opportunities, not the safe opportunities, not the trusted opportunities, but the risky opportunities, and live into your example of servanthood. We pray it in the name of Jesus, who is both Lord and servant of all. Amen.
Remember today all those whose lives were turned upside down by their encounter with Jesus, especially those at the Last Supper. We remember today those who become as servants, giving their time and effort to give clean shelter, food, and clothing to those whose well-being has been compromised by homelessness and tragedy. And now let us call to our mind's eye those in our lives that need our advocacy, presence, and prayers. You may be seated. As we continue our time of prayer this morning, I want to remind you that those prayer requests from this community can be found in your bulletin. So please keep those persons and their families in your prayers this week. As you continue to go through the week. So let's take some time for silent prayer, acknowledging those people in our community and then those things on your own hearts that you want to lift up to God this morning. Let's pray. God, you teach us that we are to care for the least of these. And you are clear that how we treat the least of these is how we treat you. We don't want to be those who say, "When did we see you in need?" We instead want to be those who have eyes to see the ways in which we can help all those who are near us and in need. So help us, O God. Help us be generous with our hearts. Help us to be generous to those who work with people every day who are in need. May we support them, honor them, give them care and rest, hope and affirming words. Help us, O God. Help us to have care and compassion to those who have no home but instead live on the streets or wherever they can find a place to lay their head. Help us to look at them as people who were created in your image just like us. Help us to look them in the eyes and affirm that they are loved by you. Help us, O God. Help us to help those who are hungry. We know it may be hard for us to imagine that there are those who go without food, but give us the courage to see them, to hear their hurt. May we give up to give others so that we may work for a world in which no person ever goes hungry. Help us, O God. Help us to be those who say we saw them, we served them, and we saw your love and grace in each and every person. Now it's in that spirit that we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now at this time, as we continue worship with the giving of our tithes and offerings, I want to remind you to pass the fellowship pads that are at the end of your rows. Especially if you're new with us, please sign in this morning. We would love to connect with you and welcome you into our community. And there's also a place for prayer requests there as well. We pray every Tuesday morning for our community, so please let us know how we can pray for you this week. Now I'll ask the ushers to come forward with the giving of our tithes and offerings.
At the end of myself, I am empty and dry. I have nothing to give but surrender inside. Let down your nets. This is not the end. From now on, you will be fishers of men. Judgment calls out my name. I've been looking for love, but I'm swallowed by shame. Throw away all your stones. Find forgiveness in me. Let me be your new passion. My daughter, you're free. Gave up on me. Now it's death I do pay. You know who I am. I am sin sacrifice. Today you will be in paradise. Follow me, follow me, follow me. God gave his only Son.
Jesus, you tell us that you came not to be served, but to serve. And this offering serve in mission and those who lead us in fellowship, those who are even now gathered with our confirmands at Chestnut Ridge this morning. All of this, Lord, we do so that we can, too, be servant leaders. We offer this and praise you, for you are the one who calls us to follow and do likewise. Amen. Please be seated. This morning, I'm excited to introduce our speaker, Reverend Dr. Elaine Heath, who these days also goes by Abbess Elaine at a new monastic community in Hillsboro. Her organization that she's getting ready to speak to us is a new missional partner for Soapstone. It's a partnership that feeds into our desire to take care of God's creation, to live healthy lives, and to serve others. And it's a community-supported agriculture. She's going to tell you a little more about it. I have to tell you that I have been a subscriber and will be a subscriber and love to eat the vegetables that come off of this farm in Hillsboro. And she's going to tell you how you can also eat those vegetables and get on board with the good works that are going on at Spring Forest.
Good morning. Thank you so much, Pastor Mitzi and Creation Care Team, for inviting me today, and I bring greetings from our community at Spring Forest. I'll be in the narthex after worship to talk to you. I have some flyers about our CSA program. The CSA program is where you subscribe to a box of vegetables every week. We also have eggs. Our current egg subscriptions are full, but we have some new girls that'll start laying in June, so we'll be able to add some more egg subscriptions. Here's a little bit of some graphics here to help you see what we're about. And I also have a sign-up sheet. I got a brand new clipboard just for you. So if you're interested in getting our twice-a-month free newsletter, it comes through email. You can tell us your email address, or if you'd like for us to give you more information about the CSA, you can sign up and just let us know of your interest. So as Pastor Mitzi said, we are a new monastic community. We're a new faith community in the North Carolina Conference. And we can go to the next slide. So we have a farm. We have 23 acres. There are three families that anchor our community. Two of us live in the two houses on the land, and then there's a third couple that live in Texas and come and go. They're part of our community. And then we have a dispersed community, so we have people that don't live on the forest, or in the forest, rather, or on the farm, that are a part of things that we do, and then we also have a digital community. So our missions have to do with environmental justice and social justice. So we provide a lot of support to refugee resettlement. We're partnered with World Relief. We have an ESL program, and we have some other programming. We provide temporary housing for refugees. And our community-supported agriculture project helps to fund these missions that we do. We also provide a lot of food to the area food banks every year, thousands of pounds from our farm. Our farm is natural. There we go, there's a little bit of information. You can see people filling the boxes there for our CSA. Our farm is, we use all natural methods. It's a regenerative farm, so it actually draws down carbon and sequesters it in the soil, which is one of the keys to reversing climate change. And we don't use any pesticides or chemicals, so the food is really healthy. It's grown with so much love. We use low-till methods so that it produces maximum health in the soil, and then that's the basis for everything, for healthy vegetables. And we pay a living wage to our farm workers. All of us on the team who are clergy-type people are bivocational, which means we don't earn our living by leading Spring Forest, but our farm workers, that's how they earn our living. And we pay our ESL translators and teachers. And so when you support our CSA, you're actually supporting all of those things. You're helping to make sure some farmers have a living wage, which is, wages for farmers are very low in North Carolina. You're helping to support refugee resettlement so people can make a new start after they've been so traumatized by war and displacement. And we're also helping to promote a healthier earth and promoting healthier families. So I hope that many of you will be willing to subscribe. We can go to the next, I think the next slide. There we go. So this is what they cost. The subscriptions are for 22 weeks, and we have a full share and a two-thirds share. We can bring the boxes to Soapstone, so you would come and on Tuesdays. We can set up the time later, and you would pick up your box every week. If you are going on vacation and don't need a box that week, you can just let us know, and we can donate that to the food bank, or we can donate it to wherever it is that you want that makes sense within our circle. So I think there might be one more slide. Yeah, Tuesdays from 4:30 to 5:45 is what we have in mind. So thank you so much, and God bless you.
We're ready for our closing hymn. If all of you will stand, please. Ready? Thank you.
So I hope you'll forgive me. I have two little commercials before we leave. One is to say that I really do love to support organizations that have good missional causes and that walk in servanthood. And one of those is Lake Junaluska, which has made incredible strides over the last few years. It's just a gorgeous place. 25 minutes on the other side of Asheville. And so if you're headed to the mountains, I always encourage you to take a look at it and stay at that hotel right there on the lake and in the mountains. And you're supporting a really good group of people who do good things in the world. And then also, as Elaine said this morning, you know, go and see her and think about supporting the CSA. I know that when I did it, it meant I didn't go to the grocery store nearly as much at all. So despite the cost, which does go to do all the good things that she said, my actual grocery costs were pretty much level because I just didn't shop as much. I just ate all of her food. So that is my two cents before we go. But as you go out into the world, look long into the face of Jesus and see what you can see and know what you can know and portion off just a little bit of that scene to see where you too can be a servant leader in the world. And as you do that, may you go in peace. Amen.
Got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil, and I better understand. I'm going through with Jesus, hallelujah. Holding to his nails, God's hands. Holding to his nails, God's hands. I got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I gotta go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil, and he better understand.
One more time.
We got one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley to